Good morning everyone. Welcome to our online class. So here we are going to continue with the chapter 6 of the Gandhian era non-cooperation movement. In the previous class we have discussed about what are the actually causes that led Gandhiji to take such a decision of the non-cooperation movement. And we have seen that cause number one, it's the Rowlatt Act, which was actually initiated by the Justice Rowlatt. And second is the Jallianwala Bagh tragedy or a great massacre, which actually changed the total scenario of the patriotic, thinking in the minds of the Indians at that time. And the third and not the least is that the Khilafat movement, okay, which was initiated by the Khilafat things that happened in the Turkey in the Ottoman Empire, and it greatly affected or influenced the Indian Muslims in India, where the two important people, that is Ali brothers, Shaukat Ali and Muhammad Ali, initiated the Khilafat movement. Okay, so let us briefly discuss what is Rowlatt Act. You know, Rowlatt Act, according to this Justice Rowlatt, has actually introduced two important bills. Okay. And in 1919 February, and as per this bills, he has authorized the government to imprison any person without trial and convict. Okay, normally what happens is that when you are arresting a person for any particular reason, any crime, etc., so we have certain formalities to be fulfilled, isn't it? It's not like that you go immediately and arrest and bring. Okay, so you have to follow certain rules that are being kept for them. And the Rowlatt Act denied all those rules. Okay, now what was the conditions or the that were actually Justice Rowlatt wanted to pass in the through the Rowlatt Act? One is that arrest of a person without warrant. You know that whenever any person is caught for in doing any crime, they are supposed to be arrested. But when they are arrested legally, and the arresting officer, whomsoever it is, they have to submit a kind of arrest warrant. Okay, this arrest warrant is a letter that the person is allowed to arrest with the justice permission, and the arrest procedure is continued. So the arrest of a person without warrant, and Justice Rowlatt has completely changed that rule. He says that now onwards there will be no arrest warrant given. So if whomsoever they feel like suspicious, whomsoever they feel like they have done something wrong, they will be arrested. Okay, the second is that in camera trial, that is trial in seclusion. So what does the camera trial actually means? You know, whenever there is a kind of, you know, interrogative sections with this sessions with this kind of, you know, criminals or person who has done something wrong, or they are even arrested for the in the suspicious case, okay, they will be given the trial. Okay, they will be that question and answering session, that is what you call it as interrogation session. So that will be going on, and it will be in the presence of some other officers. It will be nowadays we have the facilities like CCTV cameras or recording of their confessions, etc. But in those days, so it will normally it would be conducted in the presence of two or three people as the eyewitness or witness to listen to what they are actually saying. Okay, so that camera trial, that kind of, you know, trial or asking the questions or trying to give them an opportunity to speak from their side is also denied. Okay, now the third point, according to Justice Rowlatt, is that restrictions on the movements of individuals. Now when we talk about the restrictions of the movements of individuals, you know, at that time freedom struggle was something like, you know, the youngsters, the middle-aged people, even the women, every nook and corner, whenever they get gathered in any public places, they used to sit and discuss with these matters. They don't have the time to gossip, they don't have the time to peep into what others people are doing in their houses. No, they were having only one thing to discuss, and matters related to the freedom, matters related to the new ideologies set forth by the nationalistic leaders, or like some solutions for the problems that they are facing within their own community. So these were the basic, you know, topics for their discussion. So whenever they used to discuss, they used to, you know, take the places like corners of any tea shops or any kind of bridges or below the bridges. Okay, so these were the certain places, so where they used to gather. And why they have to hide and gather and discuss, it's because of the, you know, they don't want to get suspicious under the Britishers, and their plans and plannings, everything will be, you know, monitored by the Britishers. So in order to avoid such situations, they used to go and hide it. So restrictions on the movements of individuals are imposed by the Justice Rowlatt through this Rowlatt Act, where they are not supposed to gather, they are not supposed to hold meetings, they are not supposed to hold group discussions, etc. Next and the last point that Justice Rowlatt kept was that suspension of the right of habeas corpus. Okay, habeas corpus is actually writ that is being initiated, or it is there in our judiciary system even today also. And as per this habeas corpus, that any person's body it's actually a writ that gives a permission to take the custody of the body of a person who died somewhere. Okay, now suspension of the right of habeas corpus, you know that at that time in the British, in the British jails, whomsoever Indian people were arrested, they were tortured very brutally inside the jail, and they don't even reveal it to outside world that how they have done, what they have done. And in case if any person dies in that jail, it's not necessary that they will be giving the exact reason for their death. Okay, it can be like the severe torture resulted in the death. It can be like, you know, keeping them starving without food and water for many days that resulted in the death. Or it can be during the time of interrogation, and the, you know, we have the first degree, second degree, third degree type of, you know, punishments that are being given to the culprits inside the jail. So whatever could be the reason, suppose any, you know, victim died inside the jail, so their body is denied to their relatives, okay, and denied the jailers, or they don't reveal, they don't give it. Now when they give the body to the jailers, it is very clearly revealed that how brutally they have, you know, tortured. So, you know, there were many instances, if we go across to this in detail, especially when during that time they used to, you know, pluck the nails, they used to, you know, injure the eyes, okay, they spoil their eyesight, and sometimes they, you know, break the hands and the legs, you know, very, very severe and brutal kind of punishments they used to give, and they don't want this to know to the outside world, okay. And this is the reason that they took off this right of habeas corpus. Because if the person dies, they are supposed to give the body to their relatives, and when the relatives see the body of these people who are being arrested and put inside the prison, then lots of questions and lots of problems can arise. So this is the one reason that Rowlatt Act, he suspended the right of habeas corpus. Now when this act was being, you know, bill was being produced in front of the Indians, it was a great blow to all the Indians who were actually expecting the self-government. This is a time, you know, after such a long fight from 1857, and now we have reached in the 1919, somewhat around, you know, 25 to 30 years are covered, and during this time, how can a person think of, you know, going back to the same situation? So here we are struggling more and more to how to make our own country a self-government, and these people are trying to, you know, bring new rules actually. And Gandhiji very strictly appealed to the Viceroy to withhold this consent to such measures. Okay, he said that this is total injustice doing to the people, and there is no kind of any, without any, it's only to take the revenge, or it's only to show the power of the Britishers, and it's not going to benefit the Indians, and it's totally injustice to the right of the people. So he started Satyagraha as a challenge to the government, and the Rowlatt Satyagraha emerged at the first time all this Indian struggle against the British government. And in April 1919, there occurred a number of demonstrations and strikes in the country, and the British government took very brutal measures. You know, whenever Indians come up with any kind of protest, Satyagraha, Hartal, fight, etc., it's not that the Britishers always used to fold their hands and sit and watch what's going on, or how much what they are doing, etc. They used to equally come ahead with their repressive measures or suppressive measures. Okay, so the same thing happened even before also. We have seen many such instances. So the British government took brutal measures to suppress this anti-British struggle, and in fact later happened is a very, you know, painful and very, very, you know, heartbreaking kind of incident, what we call it as a Jallianwala Bagh tragedy or Jallianwala Bagh massacre under the order of the General Dyer in Amritsar on April 13th, 1919, and which was also a part of this repression. Actually, when the whole angriness that the Britishers felt towards the Rowlatt Satyagraha was actually, you know, implemented again upon those innocent people who were there gathered in the Jallianwala Bagh Park for assembled for a meeting. Okay, and now what is that? You know, this actually, this Rowlatt Act, Jallianwala Bagh, and even we are going to discuss about the Khilafat movement. All these three incidents were actually acted like a catalyst, or it like a triggered the Indian freedom struggle more fastly. Okay, so all these things, this was a call, and Gandhiji took this opportunity also to reunite the Hindus and Muslims, especially, you know, after the divide and rule policy. A few of the Muslims got separated and they made their own new India Muslim League, isn't it? Formed the Muslim League. So there was a kind of little bit of, you know, tug of war or a kind of clash between the Hindus and the Muslims. So which actually Gandhiji tried to, you know, clear it off during this particular situation. So he maximum, irrespective of Hindu, Muslim or Jain, Parsis, he maximum added people to join this Satyagraha and fight for their right and fight for their freedom. Of course, these are the right of the people, and if the people don't come ahead, then who is going to fight? What the only leaders will going to do, right? So Gandhiji try to include the maximum number of the people in these type of, you know, hartal, satyagrahas and the protest. Now we come to Jallianwala Bagh massacre or the Jallianwala Bagh tragedy. It's actually Jallianwala Bagh. Bagh means, you know, it's a garden. Okay, it's a in Amritsar. It's a very huge garden, very long garden, but there is only one entrance to this garden. So there is no two entrance or two exits that people can go from here and there. And there is only one entrance, and this garden is, you know, scattered to a very large number of area, and beside this, the boundary wall of the fencing wall of this garden is very, very high. Okay, why I am telling all these points? Because this is the reason why we understand that why couldn't the people escape when General Dyer, you know, ordered the shooting or the firing on the people. Okay, so here we come to Dr. Saifuddin Kichlu. There were many leaders who actually led, who actually gave speeches to the people regarding the freedom struggle, etc. And among them were actually Dr. Saifuddin Kichlu and Dr. Satyapal. So Jallianwala Bagh tragedy, it had only one exit in the three sides, and it was completely enclosed with the other buildings. And General Dyer, the military commander, thought that this would be like a right opportunity to hit back on Indians, and he sent his troop to this garden and with his soldiers. And after that, he closed that main entrance, and with his troops, he ordered them to start firing at the crowd. Now, the crowd means, when we talk about the crowd, it's not only the male people who were there in the park. They were female, they were children, they were even old age people. Okay, that means irrespective of the age, there were people of all different groups, okay, who were sitting there listening to those speeches made by these their leaders regarding the freedom struggle, regarding the fighting of their rights. Okay, and during this time, all of a sudden, General Dyer ordered to fire on these people, and the people caught in panic. They started running here and there. They don't know where they have to go, how they have to rescue. And since it's a park, there is no other hiding places inside that, so it is very difficult for them to get a rescue place also. Okay, so people kept on, you know, running here and there for their lives, saving themselves, and they get so, and the crowd was so thick that they even got, you know, hitting each other. Many fell down, many got injured falling down. Many of them, what they tried to climb upon that tall wall, which was actually very difficult for them to climb and jump and overcross that and rescue themselves. And those people, while they were attempting to climb, they were shot dead. And even today also, if you go to Amritsar, you can see those walls where these bullets have pierced, and that has preserved. Okay, and besides this, you know, what about the women and children? Now, it's not very that easy for the women and children to go and run and climb the wall. Okay, and many of the women and children, there was a huge well inside that particular park, okay? And many women and children in that panic, in that hurry, they did not even think for a while. They just jumped into that well and many of them died. So when all these shooting and firing was over, when all these, you know, hustle was completely finished, you can see that at that time lots of dead bodies were scattered on the land. Some hung on the trees, some hung on the walls, and lots of dead bodies were there floating on the surface of the water in the well. And this actually, you know, it's like shook the heart and mind of all the Indians, not only in India but even outside the India, where we have many Indian associations, people working there. There also they got, you know, totally shocked with this incident of Jallianwala Bagh tragedy. So this was considered as the most brutal and gruesome massacre that Britishers have ever did to Indian. And many leaders like Tagore expressed the pain and anger of the country by renouncing his knighthood, giving up the honor granted by the British. Tagore was being honored as a poet, okay, and he just, you know, threw back that knighthood, that is that title that he has got. And beside this, we can see that many of the people came ahead with their very strong reactions. Even the assertive nationalistic leaders also came up very violently, very vigorously, were hitting back to the Britishers with the, after this particular incident. So this was another reason that why Gandhiji strongly later thought of moving with the non-cooperation movement. Now, coming to the third incident is that Khilafat movement. Actually, in the First World War, you know that many of the Indians were sent to fight with the Britishers, and the Britishers promised for the self-government, which actually did not happen. Okay, now this World War time, the Turkey, which was defeated, and it was a part of the Ottoman Empire. And who was the caliph? And there was a caliph of this particular Turkey who was the main head of the administrative department or the ruling government of the Turkey at that time. Since his country was captured and he was defeated, he had to surrender. But on the other side, the caliph of any, you know, Muslim oriented country is also considered as a religious head of that country. Okay, so when they arrested, okay, politically, administrative form, government as a government, you know, work servicemen, they have the right to arrest the person, they have the right to take their rights, which is limited to their official purpose. But when the Britishers arrested the caliph here, the Sultan of Turkey, they also denied his religious head and religious position, which was actually hit back to a great number of Muslims, and it was a great blow for them because it is actually poking out to their religious sentiments. So they felt that any weakening of the caliph's position would adversely affect the position of the whole Muslim community all over the world. And the First World War, the British fought against the Turkey. Now the Muslim population, now how it influenced in India and why the Indians came up with the Khilafat movement. You know that the Muslim population in India started a very powerful agitation known as this Khilafat movement, because they understood that the very same Britishers who can be so cruel and take the rights of the Muslims in a Turkey, they can definitely do that in Indian with the Indian Muslims also. And now many of those Muslims who demanded for the formation of the Muslim League also understood the real motive of the Britishers in separating them from the Indian National Congress and initiating them or supporting them, or why they supported for a new, you know, political organization, that is the Muslim League. Okay, so the Muslim Indian Muslims came ahead with their protest to this in support of the Sultan of Turkey under the leadership of Ali brothers Muhammad Ali and Shaukat Ali. Okay, and besides this, many other Muslim leaders also joined, like Maulana Azad, Hakim Ajmal Khan, and Hazrat Mohani. Okay, so the Khilafatians, so these were called as the Khilafatians because they are initiating the Khilafat movement, formed a three point program. Means they had some three important points against. So why they are fighting? Okay, why they are actually struggling with this movement? Why they are doing all these things? They had three demands, and the number one is that the Ottoman Caliph should retain his empire. Means his empire should be given back to him. Number two, the Caliph must be left with sufficient territory to enable him to defend the Islamic faith. Okay, so now, you know, when you are arresting someone, that doesn't mean that you take the complete things from them. Limited, at least for their survival and existence, a little things will be given to them. And the second demand was that he will be giving back with respect the right of being the head of the Muslim community and also a sufficient territory to live peacefully with his people, that is Islamic people. And the third demand was that the Arab lands, that is like Arabia, Syria, Iraq and Palestine, must remain under the Muslim rule itself. The Britishers cannot take that. So Khilafat Day, they observed this October 17th, 1919 as a Khilafat Day, and in all over the India. And Gandhiji very wisely took this opportunity to ask all the Hindus and other religious people to join the Muslims for this Khilafat movement. You know, what is the point behind that? The point is that Gandhiji understood that, you know, if the Hindus and the other religious people extend their brotherhoodness by joining the hand with the Muslims in this Khilafat movement, definitely that little bit of, you know, clashes that existed between Hindu and Muslims in India, which was actually sown the seeds by the Britishers, will be completely removed. And the Muslim people also will be understanding that, yeah, after in the time of difficulty, obviously, our people are the one who are going to help to us. Okay, so there would be an empty phrase if the Hindus hold aloof from the Muslims when their vital interests are at stake. Okay, so wo kehte hai na ki like dushman ka dushman dost ban jata hai, right? So Mahatma Gandhi was elected as the president of this All India Khilafat movement and the conference, which was held in November 1919, and he advised the Khilafat committee to adopt a policy of non-cooperation movement with the government. You know, this is the time, 1919 November, don't forget the date and the year and the month, because this is time that Gandhiji first initiated the concept of non-cooperation movement in this committee when he was made the president, All India Khilafat Conference. Okay, so I hope that you understood the reasons behind the non-cooperation movement. So in coming video, let us see that how Gandhiji, what programs were initiated by the Gandhiji under this concept of this non-cooperation movement. So keep reading, stay safe, stay secure, have a good day.